You're at 3302 Country Club Drive, St. Clair Shores, Michigan.
And in 6 months, that there's some ability to move that kind of thing around, and that it's ideal for many low and middle income countries.
How did this happen? Has Johnson & Johnson responded or explained how this admittedly rare side effect occurred?
There's a lot of scientific debate about how this side effect occurs. It does seem to occur with all of the vaccines that use this adenovirus vector. It's not clear on the rates, but this side effect was also seen with the AstraZeneca vaccine. And it does seem to be involved with that vector, that it creates an immune response that causes a condition where these clots form and where you get this condition that's really very similar to something doctors see with the blood thinner heparin in rare cases. And you can imagine a world where if we just had the J&J vaccine and if there was sufficient supply, which has been another issue with this vaccine,
yeah,
where we'd be using it and we'd be quite happy with the trade-off. But the opinion of the CDC panel was that looking at the efficacy from the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines and looking at the side effect profiles of both, they were the best choice. It's a very complicated message to get to the public, though, that it's not that it's bad, but these other things are better.
That's Matt Herper with our partners at StatNews, the health and medicine publication. Thanks so much, Matt.
Thank you.
The pandemic has taken a serious toll on Americans' mental health. Studies show that one in every three people experienced elevated rates of depression this year. But a new treatment might soon offer some hope for those who are severely depressed. Researchers at Stanford University used pulses of magnetic energy to stimulate the brain in a new way, and it helped nearly 80% of patients enter remission within days. As Leslie McClurg from member station WKQED reports, the approach could be a game changer for patients in psychiatric crises. After 40 years of fighting debilitating depression, Emma was on the brink.
I was suicidal. I was going to die.
Or not using her real name because of the stigma of mental illness. The 59-year-old lives in California's Bay Area.
I have been on every medication. I have tried everything there is to try to have a semblance of normalcy.
3 years ago, Emma's psychiatrist urged her to enroll in a study at Stanford University School of Medicine, designed for people who had run out of options. For 10 hours a day, for five consecutive days, Emma sat in a chair while electric pulses stimulated her brain. She says it felt like
a woodpecker is tapping your head, and then it stops. And then about 15 seconds later, it says, up, dee, 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 and then it taps again.
At the end of the first day, she was calm. Even when her partner picked her up to drive her home, she stayed relaxed.
When he drives, I'm hysterical all the time. I'm grabbing things, I'm yelling, you know, did you see those lights? And I'm panicking constantly. And I rode home that first night, and I just looked out the window. And I enjoyed the ride.
Emma had received an individualized version of transcranial magnetic stimulation, or TMS. A coil on top of her head created a magnetic field that sent electric pulses through her skull to tickle the surface of her brain.
And you're generating current in a particular type of brain tissue, which is kind of thought to be underactive in depression.
Nolan Williams is the study's lead author and a psychiatrist at Stanford. His research was recently published in the American Journal of Psychiatry. He says TMS is designed to pump up the prefrontal cortex. That's the part of the brain that plans, dreams, and controls our emotions.
And we send a signal over and over again to remember to stay in control. And then that system comes online, and then it's able to suppress the areas of the brain that are involved with negative mood.
In other words, people feel less depressed and more in control. The study shows it may be possible to get astounding results in 5 days.
This research is a game changer, in my opinion.
Mark George is a psychiatrist and neurologist at the Medical University of South Carolina. He pioneered a TMS treatment that was approved by the Federal Food and Drug Administration for depression in 2008. It's now covered by insurance, including Medicare and Medicaid. But the problem is the regimen takes 6 weeks.
So this study shows that you can speed it all up and that you can add treatments in a given day, and it works.
The shorter treatment will increase access for a lot of people who can't get 6 weeks off work or cover childcare for that long.
The more exciting applications, however, are due to this rapidity. You know, these people got unsuicidal, undepressed within a week. Those patients are just clogging up our emergency rooms, our psych hospitals. We really don't have good treatments for acute suicidality.
Nearly 80% of patients in the most recent Stanford study crossed into remission, meaning they experienced a normal mood within days. That's what happened for Tommy Van Brocklin.
I have not had any depressed days since the treatment.
After 45 years of depression and numerous failed attempts to medicate his illness, Van Brocklin says he really didn't see a way out.
The past couple of years, I just started crying a lot, driving down the road, thinking about stuff. I'd cry, just a real emotional wreck.
So last September, he flew across the country from his home in Tennessee to spend 10 days at Stanford to be part of a small trial. Almost immediately, he started sleeping better, feeling less angry.
I wake up now, I want to come to work, whereas before, I'd rather stick a sharp stick in my eye than go to work.
He's hopeful the changes stick. More larger studies are needed to verify how long the TMS treatment will last. At least for Emma, the woman who received the treatment 3 years ago in a similar study, the results are holding. She says she still has ups and downs, but
it's an entirely different me dealing with it.
She says the treatment rewired her from the inside out.
It saved my life, and I'll be forever grateful. It saved my life.
The new TMS could be widely available by the end of 2022. That's when scientists at Stanford expect FDA clearance to come through. For Here and Now, I'm Leslie McClurg.
And you're listening to Here and Now.
And this is Michigan Radio. I'm Mike Perini. The fossil of an 8-foot-long millipede has been discovered. Don't worry, it was not found in your house. Get the story in 15 minutes. Support for Michigan Radio comes from the Charles Stewart Mott Foundation, supporting efforts to promote a just, equitable, and sustainable society in its hometown of Flint and communities around the world. More at mott.org.
I'm Jack Lepiarz. President Biden's extending a moratorium on student loan payments for another 3 months. Payments had been set to resume on February 1st for 41 million borrowers after being halted for most of the pandemic. They'll now resume on May 1st. Authorities in Nigeria had to destroy more than 1 million COVID vaccine doses that had expired. Health officials there blame more developed nations, saying they hoarded supplies and didn't donate them until they were about to expire. Just 2% of the country's population has been fully vaccinated. Existing U.S. home sales are up for the third month in a row, up nearly 2% in November. Sales on the year are up 10% from the first 11 months of 2020. The median price is also up nearly 14% from November of last year. You're listening to Here and Now.
Here and Now in Michigan. Henry Ford Health System says the current COVID-19 surge has its hospitals at a tipping point. An official says all of Henry Ford hospitals have patients waiting in the ERs for beds to free up. A state court is ordering the University of Michigan to turn over documents related to Governor Whitmer's early handling of the COVID-19 pandemic. The U of M could appeal that decision. The University of Michigan holds Michigan Radio's license. The former president of the Detroit City Council, Charles Pugh, has been released from state prison. He served 5 years for having sex with a teenage boy when he previously worked as a TV journalist. Listen for news updates throughout the day. In Michigan Radio weather, mostly cloudy in West Michigan today, a mix of sun and clouds in mid and southeast Michigan, and areas of snow. Windy at times with highs from the upper 20s to low 30s. Tonight, we'll have lows in the 20s. It's 2:20.
Funding for Here and Now comes from Aspiration, working to help people combat climate change with a credit card that lets them plant a tree with every purchase. One card, zero carbon footprint. Aspiration.com/credit. Aspiration Financial, LLC.
This is Here and Now. Big changes came to the video games industry this year. In September, we saw a flood of new games hit the market. Many of them had been pushed back because of pandemic-related delays, and major titles released games with a more diverse lineup of representation. Behind the scenes, workers called for this year, among other things, better working conditions and a push to unionize. Maddie Myers has been following all of it. She's the deputy editor for games at Polygon, and she joins us now to talk about the best games and the biggest stories of the year. Welcome, Maddie.
Hello.
Maddie, media critics are always swamped by the end of the year, but this year has been especially busy. Just how many notable games have come out recently?
Oh, so many. We've seen the release of Halo Infinite, and it's fantastic. It was supposed to come out last year along with the new Xbox, and it got delayed multiple times, in part because of the pandemic. But that's a more major game that came out this year. My personal favorite, Metroid Dread, the Nintendo game. That game came out in the fall as well, wasn't delayed, to my delight, and just... it's wonderful. That would be on the Nintendo Switch, which is still, despite new consoles coming out last year, the Nintendo Switch is still the best-selling console week after week, as I'm sure your listeners know very well.
Well, I can hear in your voice just how much you're into Metroid Dread, the latest in a series that actually started way back in 1986.
That's right.
The game opens with a lone bounty hunter on her way to a mysterious planet. Let's listen.
Bounty for this mission does not seem appropriate. This clearly outweighs the reward.
Entering the atmosphere in T-minus 10. Now.
Maddie, I'm kind of afraid listening to this. I feel
it's
like I'm going
scary.
To some dystopian world.
Yeah, you
what
are.
What do you love so much about this game?
I love going into a dystopian world, honestly. I love that the heroine Samus Aran is able to meet any alien foe she encounters and fight back with her suit of armor, her arm cannon. She flies through space in her little ship. She's a freelancer. As somebody who works in journalism, I could always relate to that side of things. All of that resonated with me. And Samus has been around as one of the first prominent female characters in games back in 1986. And now it's just kind of normal that a lady in armor is out there fighting in a video game on a major console, the Nintendo Switch. And that's kind of neat. And to me, sums up a lot of what I think we're about to talk about today with how much games have changed, especially this year, and how exciting of an industry they've become.
Right. I mean, 2021 has been a big year for representation. The shooter game Deathloop has not one, but two black leads. And they've got jokes. Let's listen.
How does it feel to be dead?
At least I left a pretty corpse.
Next time, folks, listen out for the morning. Situational awareness. What the No wonder she hates me. She misses all my best material.
Okay, this sounds really entertaining. Tell us a little bit more about it.
It's very entertaining. So Deathloop is a game that plays with the idea of dying and starting back over again, but these characters remember it every single time they die because they're trapped on an island together, stuck in a time loop. And one of them, the male character Colt, is trying to escape the time loop, and the female character Juliana wants to preserve it and live forever. And so they are in constant battle, trading quips with each other, very hilarious dialogue. Mm. And the fact that it's two black leads and a game that was award-winning, nominated across many publications. It's on our top 50 games of the year at Polygon as well, is pretty incredible. Again, compared to even 5-10 years ago, be hard pressed to think of a game with a black lead, let alone two. But what the tension is that I see is that then the programmers and artists and everyone else, the video game CEOs, are still usually white, straight guys, and those are the people who are making a lot more money. And that's the part that, as somebody who reports on the industry, I'm really interested in unpacking some of that and seeing if we can share that wealth and also bring more people in to make the games that are featuring more and more diverse people.
Well, we've been talking quite a bit this year about working conditions for the gaming industry. One of the biggest controversies this year, the state of California sued Activision Blizzard, which produces the massively popular Call of Duty and the World of Warcraft games. Well, October claims of sexual harassment and discrimination. There have been, since then, more allegations of abuse. Workers have been protesting. Walk us through this. How did this story start and where is it going?
So this story probably actually started 10 years ago, as some of the allegations in this lawsuit claim, where many marginalized people who worked there, especially female employees and female employees of color, were experiencing sexual harassment on the job, massive pay discrepancies. Their work was getting sidelined and ignored, or so they say, according to this lawsuit's terms. And those workers' stories are finally coming out, and Activision Blizzard has had to actually respond to this lawsuit. At this point, it's become multiple lawsuits, and the workers have been actually bonded together publicly in what they're calling the ABK Workers Alliance. It's not an official union that's recognized, but they have some unionization discussion happening amongst them, and they've been receiving some emails from management that, I would say, in my personal opinion, seem to be discouraging unionization, but clearly the workers are banding together in order to push back against what some are calling a sexist workplace, as well as a toxic culture of overwork. And that's right. Just been fascinating to see unfolding this past year.
Yeah, I mean, we're actually seeing some places like the small studio Rodeo Games actually unionizing. You mentioned Activision Blizzard employees have been trying to unionize. Mm-hmm. What does this tell you about the state of the labor market overall in the industry? Do you think it's going towards unionization across the board?
I really hope so. It's extremely difficult for a very large studio like Activision Blizzard to unionize because there are so many employees across different studios. But something like Vodeo Games, which is a smaller studio that does have workers in both Canada and the U.S., they have 13 employees. That small studio, where they're already relatively happy as independent game creators, they were able to sign a union contract together and get recognized by management without too much fuss. Okay, Activision Blizzard, that's 9,500 employees. That's a huge amount of people, and not all of those people are necessarily going to want to be in the union. Should the artists be in the same union as the programmers? Should the audio designers be there? What about contract workers? The list goes on and on. I think the solution we're going to see eventually is something akin to the film industry, where we see unions for different kinds of jobs. Voice actors for games are often already unionized. This isn't as much of an issue for them as it is for, say, an audio designer who's mixing their voice tracks, who isn't in a union. And the other piece of your question that's implied, I think, is the extent to which the pandemic and remote work has also changed the conversation around work in general. And that's absolutely happened in video games as well, where workers are now suddenly able to identify the issues with work-life balance that they were actually having all along and advocate for themselves in the midst of a stressful situation for workers across every industry in the world.
Well, Maddie, before I let you go, I want us to take a step back. Video games are not only getting more culturally important, we're seeing changes behind the scenes, as you mentioned here. More companies are moving into this space. I mentioned Netflix is pushing their own mobile games now, not to mention the big budget shows it funded based on game franchises like this year's hit Arcane. Let's listen.
Power, real power, doesn't come to those who are born strongest or fastest.